Welcome you all for a new video on the Ebers Moll model of bipolar junction transistor. As we all know that the bipolar junction transistor can be considered essentially in terms of two different configurations, one as NPN and the other one as PNP. Here in this particular video, we are going to concentrate on the Ebers Moll model of NPN bipolar junction transistor. To begin with, the Ebers Moll model of NPN BJT, first, let us understand about the BJT and the PN junction diode analogy. Because we are very sure that the bipolar junction transistor can be constructed as two PN junction diodes which are placed back to back. So with the base as P-type region and this base region being common for both these PN junction diodes. And this part is where you have the first PN junction diode, which forms the emitter to base junction, and the second PN junction is between the base and the collector terminals. As we know that we have considered an NPN transistor, the emitter is of N-type semiconductor and the base region is made of P-type semiconductor and collector region is made of again the N-type semiconductor. The voltage drop across the diode, the first PN junction diode, as base to emitter voltage, and the voltage drop across the second PN junction diode, which is between the base and the collector junction, has also been given for you. And also we can understand that the current through each diodes are dependent on what conditions that are prevailing with respect to the each and every PN junction diode, because they are not actually isolated, they're not separated, they're actually connected back to back, which means the current emitter current is totally dependent on the base and the collector current. And if you consider this as a nodal point, and when you can apply Kirchhoff's current law, the sum of currents entering the node will be equal to the sum of current leaving the node. And here it is very clear that the sum of current leaving the node is the total emitter current, which is the sum of the base current and the collector current. As we've understood that the transistor has a dependency with respect to the PN junction diode, first let us have a quick recap on the PN junction diode currents. As we know, the general equation of diode current goes like this: the total diode current is equivalent to the reverse saturation current, which is contributed by the minority charge carriers, into exponential of capital V by eta Vt minus 1. And capital V is the external applied voltage based on which the biasing is going to change, and eta is a constant which is dependent on the semiconducting material that we choose, which is for the germanium material it's going to be 1 and for the silicon material it's going to be 2. And the thermal voltage Vt can be expanded as kt by q, where k is the Boltzmann constant and t is the temperature and q or e is the electronic charge. When the diode has to be reverse biased, we know that we have to apply a negative external applied voltage to the P-type semiconductor, and then it becomes a reverse bias, and therefore the equation also becomes exponential of minus V by eta times Vt. And also if the voltage, the applied voltage, is going to be very much greater than the thermal voltage, then the term exponential of minus V by eta Vt becomes very much negligible when compared to this one. Hence, the total diode current in the reverse biased condition becomes equivalent to minus I naught, where I naught is the reverse saturation current contributed by the minority charge carrier moment. And this equation is especially valid only when the applied voltage is going to be lesser than the breakdown voltage, because once it exceeds the breakdown voltage, either avalanche breakdown will exist, or in case of a Zener diode, Zener breakdown starts to occur. And the reverse saturation current takes this particular form, where A is the area of cross section, E is the electronic charge, dP is the hole diffusion coefficient, and dN here, it is the electron diffusion coefficient, because all these things are happening because of the diffusion of minority charge carriers between the P-type and the N-type semiconductor. PN naught is the equilibrium hole concentration on the N-type semiconductor, and NP naught is the equilibrium electron. So whatever that is given in the first letter, that indicates the concentration of the charge carrier. So here it is P, so therefore it is indicating the hole concentration, but the hole concentration on the N side at the equilibrium condition. Okay, and similarly, this is the electron concentration on the p-side at the equilibrium condition. And then we need to understand what is Ln, which is the electron diffusion length, and Lp, which is the hole diffusion length, which takes the form of square root of dn tau n. This is completely because of the Einstein's relation. And here we have got tau n tau p to be the carrier lifetime. Also, we know that from the mass action law, the equilibrium carrier concentration product can be written as ni squared, where ni is the intrinsic carrier concentration. And n naught can be obtained from the same mass action law as ni squared by p naught, and p naught, the whole concentration at the equilibrium condition, can be obtained from ni squared by n naught. So everywhere here, we have started to discuss about the thermal equilibrium condition, because the suffix is clearly indicating the equilibrium condition. So therefore, first we need to understand what is the PN junction at thermal equilibrium condition. What does that define as? So under thermal equilibrium, the carrier concentrations in the neutral regions, which means the regions outside the depletion region, are called as a neutral regions. The carrier concentrations in the neutral regions are same as the carrier concentrations in the isolated p-type and n-type materials. And the depletion layer is completely depleted of mobile charge carriers. And also we need to understand, under thermal equilibrium, when it comes to the current, diode currents, the net current across the junction will also be zero. So with this understanding, let us also know what is this equilibrium majority carrier concentration on the PZ, because we need to understand on the p-type and the n-type material, what are the carrier concentrations, which means in terms of majority and in terms of minority carrier concentration. So first let us understand the majority carrier concentration on p-side, because first I have taken into consideration about the hole. Okay, so the P is indicating, the first letter P is indicating you the carrier concentration, and since it is P, it is denoting you the hole concentration, and holes are the majority charge carriers for the P-type material, and therefore at the equilibrium condition, it will be equivalent to the acceptor doping concentration, because a P-type semiconductor can be formed from an intrinsic condition only with the addition of acceptor doping concentration. So therefore, the majority carrier concentration on the PZ will be equivalent to the Na, which is acceptor doping concentration, but the equilibrium minority carrier concentration on the N side, because the P-type charge carriers, which are the holes, they become minority carrier concentration for the N-type semiconductor. So therefore, look at the notation here. It is P suffix N naught. N is denoting you on which side we are looking into, which is equivalent to Ni squared by Nd, which means from a mass action law, we are able to identify what is the equilibrium minority carrier concentration on the other side of the semiconductor. Similarly, the other carrier concentration, which means the majority carrier concentration on the N side, which are the electrons, and similarly, the minority carrier concentration, minority electrons on the P side, can be obtained from the mass action law. So now coming to our reverse saturation current, our main interest is to replace the P and not an N. You know, that is why we had all these discussions about the carrier concentrations at the equilibrium condition. Therefore, now we have P and not and NP not that can be replaced together. And we have a common term, which is Ni squared, that can be separated so that the equation can be reframed in this structure. Now moving forward with our main discussion, which is the Ebers Moll model of NPN bipolar junction transistor. So this is a large signal model. This is not whenever we speak about the modeling, it becomes this AC small signal modeling. No, it is not like that. It is here a large signal model, which is representing the BJT in any mode of operation, which means the DC terminal currents in any mode of operation can be evaluated using this Ebers Moll model. And here, this video talks to you very particularly about the modeling of NPN bipolar junction transistor. The Ebers Moll model has two PN junction diodes that are connected back to back. And here we have two dependent current sources to just describe the interaction between the two PN junctions. And the voltage drop across the junctions have been indicated, along with the emitter current, base current, and the collector current. And here we have this diode current indicated as IF, and the collector base junction diode current has been indicated as IR, and alpha F and alpha R these two are the forward and the reverse transfer ratios, where alpha F is the ratio, forward transfer ratio, when the emitter base junction is forward bias and the collector base junction is reverse bias. Whereas alpha R is the reverse transfer ratio when the collector base junction is forward bias and the emitter base junction is reverse bias, because in this case we do consider that the collector is acting as a emitter and the emitter acts as the collector. Taking the same Ebers Moll model into consideration, here I have just given the diode current. So here for this particular first PN junction diode, between the base and the emitter junction is the forward current IF, which is equivalent to the reverse saturation current IAS, because it is from base to emitter junction and the corresponding voltage drop across that particular diode has been indicated as VBE. And the reverse saturation current, we know the expression, that can be expanded as EANI square into the suffix, whichever I have given here is with respect to the base, it is indicated as B, and for the emitter region, it is indicated as E. So accordingly, the expressions have been modified for the reverse saturation current, and similarly when it comes to the collector to base junction. Okay, so the base is of P type and collector is of N type, so it is the base to collector junction. So here the reverse saturation current will be at the collector end, and that ICS has also been expanded here with respect to the base as the P type and collector as the N type, and the voltage drop across the terminal will be VBC. Now, as our objective is to determine the DC terminal currents of the Ebers Moll model of an NPN transistor, we first go blindly with applying the Kirchhoff's current law. Therefore, we obtain the emitter current IE equivalent to IF, which is entering the node. Okay, so this is the node that we have to consider. This is leaving the node IE. And similarly, alpha R IR is also leaving the node. So therefore, it will be IE plus alpha R IR equal to IF. But since we need to write it in terms of the terminal current IE, I write it as IF minus alpha R IR. Similarly, IC will be equivalent to alpha F IF minus IR. And we know that since IE is equal to IB plus IC, we need to estimate what is the base terminal current, which is IB is equivalent to IE minus IC. Now we can just directly substitute what is this IF and IR, and the terminal current equations comes like this with the applied IF and IR equations, and the values of the forward and the reverse transfer ratios are also given here. So maybe you can think that, yes, we have found out all the DC terminal current and that's the end of the Ebers Moll model. No, our objective was to determine the DC terminal currents in any mode of operation. That is the advantage of using this Ebers Moll model, where we have four different modes of operation. The first mode of operation that comes into discussion is the cutoff mode. So where I've taken the general expressions of all the DC terminal currents after the substitution of IF and IR, and now we have to discuss about the cutoff mode, where we know that the base emitter junction will be unbiased, VBE becomes zero. And substituting this VBE equal to zero in the exponential term, it becomes exponential of zero by VT, which is exponential of zero, which is equivalent to one. And with respect to the base to collector junction, it will be of reverse bias, and therefore the base to collector voltage will be negative. And when this base to collector voltage is going to be negative, this exponential term will be very much lesser when compared to this one. So therefore, the terminal currents takes this form, because we are going to substitute e to the power 0 for VB equal to 0 as 1. So after the substitution of these values in the terminal currents, then we obtain IE as approximately equivalent to alpha R times ICS. And IC will be approximately equivalent to ICS, because this term will completely vanish, and this exponential of VBC by VT will also be lesser than negligible to 1. So therefore, only ICS term will remain. And similarly, IB, the left out terms will be minus of 1 minus alpha R into ICS. So this is your cutoff mode. So this is very equivalent to an open state switch. Now starting a discussion for the second mode of operation, which is the saturation mode, where we know the conditions for the base emitter junction and the base collector junction, which has to be both forward bias. So when it forward bias, the external applied voltage will be very much greater. So therefore, the exponential terms, which contains VBE and VBC terms, will be approximately much greater than this one. So therefore, After you substitute all these approximations in the DC terminal currents, the final DC terminal current will look like. So whenever it is greater than one, we have to neglect one, because whichever is smaller, we are trying to understand an approximate model only. So when the approximation terms have to be obtained, just ignore the negligible terms. So only these terms will become the considerable ones, and accordingly the terminal currents will vary. And for a saturation mode, the NPN transistor will behave like a closed state switch. Similarly, for the third mode, which is the forward active mode, the base to emitter junction will be forward biased and the base collector junction will be reverse biased, and accordingly the conditions vary, and the same approximations we can just apply to these general equations and find out the approximate DC terminal currents for forward active mode. And for this particular mode, we can understand that IE, the emitter current, will be approximately equivalent to IE is into exponential of VBE by VT. This will be relatively large. Similarly, the collector current will also be relatively large, because the base current is going to be small, because it's just 1 minus alpha F into IE. Finally, into the final mode of operation, which is the reverse active mode of the NPN transistor. Here, the same general expressions of the DC terminal currents have been taken, but the conditions for the base to emitter junction and the base to collector junction will vary, because the base emitter junction will be reverse biased and the base to collector junction will be forward biased. Accordingly, the exponential terms will take its different form, and the final DC terminal currents for the reverse active mode of the NPN transistor is given here. And this concludes the video of the Ebers Moll model of an NPN configuration of a bipolar junction transistor. And it is not a small signal modeling, because basically we have an understanding whenever it comes to modeling, we try to understand that it's only going to be a small signal model. But this is purely a large signal model, where we try to identify or estimate the DC terminal currents with four different modes of operation of NPN based BJT. And here in this particular video, we gradually started with understanding of the analogy between the PN junction diode and BJT. And we have also recollected what are the reverse saturation currents, the total forward current and the reverse currents of a PN junction diode. Because the same understanding only we have taken forward for understanding the Ebers Moll model in four different modes of operation. Meet you all in another interesting video in the upcoming weeks. Until then, thank you all for watching this video through Electronics Insight channel.